I'm very glad to give you a lecture on culture, worldview, and gospel worldview today. Let me start by introducing myself briefly. As you can see here, my name is Timothy Chung, and I am a visiting professor at Asian Center for Theological Studies and Mission, and I'm an evangelical Christian serving an interdenominational evangelical church in Seoul. I studied at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School in the U.S. And completed my degree in 2011. I'm also a tent maker missionary specializing in teaching to seminaries and students at seminaries worldwide. Yeah, briefly, that's who I am. And again, I'm very happy to have this opportunity to give you a short lecture on this topic. This lecture will last about 90 minutes, and it will cover, as you can see here, basically it will cover culture and worldview before we move on to gospel worldview or Christian worldview. But to understand the topics in right perspective and context, we need to look into culture and worldview at a deeper level. So that's what I'm going to do at the start of the lecture. So please bear with me when we talk about culture and worldview, because that's what we need to lay out as our context for Christian worldview studies. And before that, of course, as a setting, I would like to start with theology and its task, so that we can understand this topic in the right context of a theology, which is very much we need to do, and we need to understand properly. Another thing I would like to mention at the outset is, as I put it in here, my lecture, the key points of my lecture are all prepared in very readable PowerPoint slides, and the key points are put in sentences, and these sentences are put in quite understandable and logical sequences, so that if you can read through, then you can understand much better in addition to what you listen to me. So my recommendation is that you please read it through as well as you listen to me when I speak. So that's my suggestion to you at the outset. Okay, having said this, let's move on, get into today's study. I would like to start this class, this lecture, by reading two Bible texts relevant to worldviews. Two verses I have chosen. One is coming from Romans 1:16, and another is coming from Ephesians 6:10-12. Why don't we read together? First, Romans 1:16. Let's read together. Go. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. Next one is coming from Ephesians 6:10-12. Again, let's read together. Go. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against the flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Amen. Okay, as I said, today's topic of our study in bigger context, in the context of theology. So I put it in here, a subtitle called Theology and Its Task. So let's have a look first on this topic. As you know very well, theology is basically to study and love God. And also theology is to study the truth he has given the church through the inspired word of God. In addition, theology is also to study the recipients of the word and their context, particularly cultural context. And we do this study by way of reflection of a whole person. With this in mind, today's topic, the study on worldview and culture, is actually specifically to do a little more into this study of recipients and their context, particularly cultural context. That's the context that we are talking. All right. In addition, since we are talking theology, I'd like to introduce these two things. First, the theology's main task. Main task of theology is, of course, biblical interpretation, which is the soul of a theology and its application in new cultural context. In other words, interpretation of Bible and application of what we interpret in new cultural context, whether it is in Manila, Seoul, or Athens, Rome, or Phnom Penh. So that's theology's main task, okay? All right, in addition, we can also look at theology's three elements which we need to understand the theology properly. First is, of course, confession of faith. Confession of our believing and submitting to the truth of His word. That's the confession of faith. And then, secondly, reflection on cultural context of recipients of the word. The one actually we are studying today is in relation to this cultural context. And thirdly, lastly, cultivation of virtues that constitute a wisdom of life and reflect the confession and the reflection. Theology requires us to cultivate virtues which are compatible, which are consistent with what the Word of God teaches us. And that makes up what you call wisdom of life we need for our lives. Okay, having just looked at theology and its task, now let's move on to today's main topic. But I would like to touch this question first. Why culture and why worldview? Perhaps quite naturally you would ask, why do we bother with the culture or worldview? So to that question, I have these as a kind of an answer to that question. Okay, so let's take a look. Why culture? Why do we bother with the culture? Because first, to know a person well requires that his culture needs to be understood, mm-hmm. because it forms the main part of his identity. Mm-hmm. One's identity is very much actually comprised, constituted by one's culture. So in order to understand a person at a deeper level, we need to understand, we need to know his culture. That's why we need to study culture. Okay. And secondly, we need to study culture because to study and understand cultural context is an important part of the main task of theology, as we just considered. Okay. So we have to understand cultural context to our theology properly. Okay. Then next question, why do we concern ourselves with the worldview. Worldview is a big topic, actually, but everybody talks about it. But then we need to know worldview correctly at its full worth. Why do we bother with worldview? Because worldview is the core of a culture. We'll shortly see that culture consists of three levels. And then out of the three levels, worldview consists of the bottom level, the core. So to understand culture, we need to understand worldview, because it is the core of culture. And the worldview is very important because it influences values and beliefs a person has, which in turn influences that person's behaviors, symbols, languages, songs, poetries, all those, okay, which make up the external level of culture. You see, because of these, we need to study worldview, and which is very much important part of culture. Okay. Now, let's grasp the definition of a culture. What do we mean by culture? Before we come to this definition, I would like to point out that the definition and other basics are coming from a number of academic disciplines, particularly cultural anthropology, history, sociology, religious studies, psychology, mission studies. And out of these academic disciplines, I have drawn basics of culture, including definition of culture. Okay. So this definition, we can come up with two definitions. And this definition is coming from anthropology. The first definition of culture is this, number one, different sets of values, beliefs, and practices of a people, of a person, of people, like a tribe, a group, a nation, or a country. A set of values and beliefs and practices of a person or of a group of people. That's a definition of a culture. The second definition, which perhaps is a more general definition, is culture is a human system or human frame of the patterns of learned beliefs and behaviors that order activities of a person or a group of people. Our lives, consisting of activities, actually these activities are ordered by our culture. That's what it says here. And culture is a human frame of the patterns of beliefs and behaviors. So culture is quite important, actually. Mm-hmm. Without which we cannot understand underlying causes of our activities and behaviors. Now, after definition of culture, we need to find out what definition of worldview is. I have prepared here three definitions, actually, which are all related and which gives a different shade, a different aspect, but overall, these three sum up definition of worldview quite well. The first one is worldview is a set of foundational presuppositions and beliefs one holds about basic makeup of a reality world, God, spiritual world, life, etc., usually shared by a group of people. A set of foundational presuppositions, this is a bit difficult word, but basically we can say assumptions. Foundational assumptions, okay? Not ordinary day-to-day assumptions, but foundational, very basic assumptions and beliefs one person holds about basic makeup of reality world. Okay? Worldview itself, intuitively says that we have a certain view of world, all right? So that's what it means here. One's assumptions and beliefs about makeup of a reality world, God, spiritual world, life, etc. And this these assumptions and beliefs are shared by a group of people, okay? People of the same culture. Okay? And second definition is a set of answers to big questions of world and life. I like this actually. When you preach or when you teach, particularly to those students, inquisitive students or intellectuals, they usually have big questions, okay? Big questions are questions regarding these things, okay? And then these big questions need to be addressed, need to be answered. And the answers are coming from worldview, okay? You see? So worldview is a set of answers to big questions of world and life. That's why it is so important a tool for even your preaching and teaching. Next definition is a frame of reference one holds through and live by and through which one sees the world. This is another good definition, actually. Actually, anyone or a group of people in the same culture looks at, sees the world with a certain frame of reference, like a special pair, certain glasses. Okay? They look, they see the world, and that's their worldview, okay? And the example will explain a little better, like a Confucian worldview, Buddhist worldview, animist worldview, Christian worldview. If you are Confucian, and for example, if you are ordinary people living in East Asia, like China, Korea, Japan, you are quite likely Confucian. And Confucian means you look at world with the Confucian worldview. The worldview taught by Confucian classical books. Confucius himself taught, and his disciples wrote the classical books, all right? And those books teach what the world is and what the values are, those things. And what is life's meaning, right? Those things are all taught by Confucian worldview. Same goes with the Buddhist worldview. And animist worldview, this is interesting but very important, okay? Regardless of these different world-class religions, most of people, particularly people in Africa, South America, and Asia, in developing countries, particularly like, tribal, mountain people and others, most of them are, from birth they are animists, okay? Because their view is animistic view. Their view of world is animist view, right? World, full of spirits and, energies and powers and all those, okay? So animist worldview is kind of a worldview underlying all these different worldview, okay? Christian worldview, of course. If you are a good Christian, if you read the Bible and if you see the world by what Bible teaches, then you have a Christian worldview, right? Quite often, many of us Christians do not recognize, Christian faith as a Christian worldview, which is really something we need to address, right? So I'll come to that actually shortly, right? But Christian worldview is very, very important. Gospel itself is a comprehensive worldview. Okay? So if we understand gospel, in that context, then that certainly gives you additional, material and additional tools for your preaching and teaching. All right, because of these three, worldview determines one's view of world, one's attitudes, and one's morals of the world, life and happiness. That's why it is so important. That's the basic, frame of reference by which one sees the world, by which one views the world, and then by which one's attitude to world is determined, and by which one's morals, moral grounds and morals are determined. Okay? And of course, happiness and others are all dependent upon that. So that's why it is so important. That's why we need to study it and understand it. It is a full world.